Hi class, this is going to be my first time doing a screencastify. I hope it goes well. Please give me any feedback. So I want to talk to you today about deconstruction, and this is just an introduction. I'm not going to be able to tell you everything that there is to know about deconstruction in one lesson. However, it's a good taste. So at the beginning of the class, we talked about why do we study theory? What's the point of it? And it's really about dealing consciously with ideologies. Sula is a really great book to talk about ideologies with, because Toni Morrison's ideology and your ideology might be worlds apart. In a million years, you might never think that it's a good idea to cut off your leg to save your children's lives. You might not think that it's a good idea to burn your son alive because he has a drug addiction. These are not part of your ideology, but you have to understand Toni Morrison's ideology in order to understand this book. So I have this quote that we put up at the beginning of the year as well. The chief part of it that I want you to pay attention to is that theory is subversive because it puts authority in question. First thing that we want to do to talk about deconstruction today, I want you to close your eyes. I know it's weird. It'll work better if you just do it. So as soon as you're ready, I want you to click to the next slide and shut them. Put your head down if you need to, block out the outside world, whatever, but close your eyes. You ready? When your eyes are closed, I want you to imagine a darkened space. And into this darkened space, I want you to place an apple. I want you to think about the size of the apple, the color of the apple, the way the skin of the apple feels, the way that it feels when you bite into it. Is it crunchy? Is it juicy? Is it soft? Does the juice dribble down your chin? Is it tart? Is it sweet? Is it a mix of both? As you're eating it, what does it smell like? How do you feel as you're tasting it? Once you have that apple fixed firmly in your mind, open your eyes. Okay, so some of you imagined a yellow apple, a green apple, a red apple. A lot of you probably thought about a mottled colored apple like a Honeycrisp because we're Minnesotans. What I want you to remember was the taste of it, the texture of it. Did any of you imagine your apple with a bite taken out of it? Some people don't know what that imaginary apple tastes like unless they envision taking a bite out of it. Did any of you have an apple with a stem on it or even a leaf still attached to it? A worm coming out of it? I blame the kindergarten teachers for that. Did any of you have an apple that was still on the tree? Those are the basic questions. But the second ones I have for you, was your apple cut in any way? Did anyone picture it in a pie or a tart or with caramel on it or peanut butter on it? Was anyone amused by the idea, oh, this is my teacher asking me to picture an apple, you know, an apple for the teacher? Although, to be honest, I think I've only gotten a couple in my entire career. Did anyone think about Snow White and the Wicked Witch and the poison apple? Or if you know your mythology, Paris and the Apple of Discord, where he was supposed to choose which goddess to give the apple to. Atalanta was the fastest runner, and her father wanted her to marry, And she said, only if someone could beat her in a foot race. So one guy got a golden apple and he threw it down in her path while she was running and she stopped for it. Then we've got American mythologies. William Tell shooting an apple off of his son's head. Or Isaac Newton when he was coming up with the idea for gravity. That's probably a myth too. What about Adam and Eve? Some of you made those associations when I said an apple. Language is so slippery, and that's part of deconstruction. Ferdinand de Saussure is a big name in deconstruction. He says words aren't ideas. They're just signs that we have standing in for ideas. So everybody who's looking at this slideshow right now and listening to the sound of my voice, you thought of different apples. So there is no such thing as one apple. It doesn't have a fixed meaning. It has many. It has as many meanings as it has hearers or readers or thinkers. Apple is an imperfect sign for the idea that it represents because we don't all think of the same thing. Further still, Heraclitus said, no man ever steps in the same river twice, for it's not the same river, and he's not the same man. So we're not picturing the same apple at different points in our lives. The apple I'm thinking of today might be very different from the apple that I thought of yesterday, or definitely 10 years ago, or when I was in your shoes in a desk in a classroom. This is all about logocentrism. Logo means word, but it also means speech and reason, law, truth. So to be a logocentric culture, like we are in our Western world, language, words are everything that we revolve around. That those are supposed to be universal, but I just proved that Apple is not universal. Why do we care? Well, a deconstructionist critic says that there's no such thing as a text. There's no poem. There's no book. There's no play. There are as many of those texts as that piece has readers. And as many times as you've read it, that's how many copies of that text there are. So think about, why do people reread books? Have you ever read a book again? What did you see in the book the second time that you read it? The third? Why was it different? What was going on in your life that made it different? In the world that made it different? Inside you that made it different? Reading Albert Camus' The Plague right now is very different because of this whole COVID-19 thing. We build assumptions on our experience of history and culture and art and popular ideologies and our personal encounters. According to a deconstructivist critic, we base our expectations on what we assume is shared, but not everything is shared. I want you to remember, earlier this year, we read the poem by Yeats, Slouching Toward Bethlehem. It's the one that starts, turning and turning in the widening gyre, the falcon cannot hear the falconer. The key line here is, things fall apart. The center cannot hold. Yeats was expressing a very modernist idea. In World War I, the belief in human goodness was shattered. People felt alienated from one another. They could no longer count on a set of unifying beliefs or behaviors, things as simple as thou shalt not kill. Well, in the middle of the war, that got to be pretty different. And because of that, art veered away from linearity and harmony. The center wasn't maintaining its role as the turning point around which all else revolves. As a result of that, art became less pretty, less harmonic, less representational, less uplifting. And audiences were looking to art to make sense out of the randomness of life. And they became really disillusioned with their artists. And that's when the big rift started to grow between high and low culture. High culture is, oh, the opera. I will go and I will listen to Bach and classical music. And low culture is, I'm going to rock out to Rihanna. Okay? And should those things actually be distinguished from each other? Aren't they both art? Don't they both have something to say about our modern condition? Postmodernism came with World War II, the Holocaust, the atomic bomb. All of that was just so incredibly disruptive to our ideas. I was going to say something else about what was happening in the world with World War II, but I'll leave it at that. And people realized that the inability of language to connect one human being with another, it just couldn't convey everything that we wanted to convey. So, if Yeats is very modernist, with the center cannot hold, a postmodernist says, what if there is no center? The idea that human beings have a unified and findable self, that's just a fantasy, because human beings are just masses of contradictions and social constructions. We're all over the place. Deconstruction is a strategy of critical questioning directed towards exposing unquestionable assumptions and internal contradictions, and questioning those assumptions and pointing out those contradictions. Deconstruction often involves a way of reading that concerns itself with decentering, with unmasking the problematic nature of all of these centers. It's all about how we see rather than what we see. So in the same way, we can analyze how the assumed conventions of a friendship story do or don't work in the novel Sula. First, a modernist would say, oh, this center does not hold. This is not a traditional friendship story. But a postmodernist would say, there is no center. What is a traditional friendship story? Who gets to decide? The reader can find endless meaning. There's no single center, essence, or meaning in the literature. So modernism, there's an absolute universal truth that we can understand through rationalism and logic. We're becoming disenchanted with material truth, and we're searching for an abstract truth instead. But postmodernism, there is no universal truth. Rationality by itself does not help us truly understand the world. How do you explain the Holocaust? How do you explain the horrors of World War II, much less Korea and Vietnam and the Iraq War, the Gulf War, 9/11? There's no universal truth, abstract or otherwise. No point looking for it. Many modernists think that works of art can provide that unity, coherence, and meaning which was lost in modern life. Art will do what other human institutions fail to do. Education will do what other human institutions fail to do. Postmodernists don't find fragmentation or incoherence. They don't mind them. They celebrate that lack of meaning. Let's not pretend that art can make meaning. Art just makes us feel things. So what do they share in their art? Modernism and postmodernism avoid an omniscient point of view or a single narrator. They both blur lines between different genres. They both link fragmented forms or discontinuous narratives. There's a tendency toward reflexivity. They tend to write about writing and talk about the nature of story. We see a little bit of that in the N-word joke at the beginning of the book, where it's talking about the nature of the bottom. So how are modernism and postmodernism different? As I said, the center will not hold this no objective absolute truth. Ideas are viewed as social constructions in postmodernism. It's a broad movement. There's a lot in it. Hold that thought. Let's see. Alienation, fragmentation are tenets of postmodernism. Their aesthetics, less is more. Willa Cather wrote a great essay about how there's too much furniture in a house. And Samuel Beckett's play, Waiting for Godot, is just surreal. So in modernism, we look for what is the central meaning in the story and how do characters feel alienated. But in postmodernism, we say, what should be the center in this text? But it's not there. What absences or contradictions are there? Some of the key terms I want to talk about, aporia. Aporia is the moment when a misconception is stripped away and we're left in this state of confusion, lacking any clarity. Then we have to reconstruct what our true knowledge is. We have to go through this doubt, this puzzlement without a poros or path in Greek. The process implies this physical and mental effort of searching. Aporia is that moment of undecidability, the inherent contradictions found in any text. Derrida, for example, cites the inherent contradictions at work in Jean-Jacques Rousseau's use of the words culture and nature by demonstrating that Rousseau's sense of the self's innocence in nature is already corrupted by the concept of culture and existence, and vice versa. It's this idea that we're not tabula rasa. We're not blank slates for the world to write upon. We already have some sense of the world from the moment of birth. So, aporia. You're also going to look for paradoxes in a text. Where are two things both true at the same time, and yet they contradict each other? Where is there ambiguity? Room for you to read it in different ways. Where's there a tension in the text? You're not really sure what you're supposed to be getting out of it, what a correct reading is, or you and another reader see things really differently, and there's tension between those readings. Binary oppositions are really big in deconstruction. It looks at the idea of black and white and says, are these opposites? Do we have assumptions about what black is and what white is that might be wrong? How about male and female? We set those up as binary opposites, but are they really, or is it more of a spectrum? Finally, a deconstructionist looks for absences, gaps, and they look for the trace that's left behind. So where is there a time jump? Where is there a character missing from a scene? Where is there an explanation missing that we need in order to construct our understanding? So I want to talk a little bit about postmodernism and deconstruction. I'm mostly using those terms interchangeably. Postmodernism is taken a little bit further in deconstruction. There's no stability anywhere, not even in language. A deconstructionist looks for what isn't there. You have to look for paradoxes, contradictions, look for breaks in time or point of view, look for absences, omissions, look for internal conflicts. A deconstructionist wants to find textual disunity. That's what you do as a reader. And deconstructionism is really something readers do. Postmodernism is a style of writing. It's what writers do. A writer leaves gaps or holes for the reader to squeeze in. A writer creates paradoxes or contradictions within the text. A writer breaks chronology or point of view. A writer makes these absences or omissions and inserts internal conflicts. A postmodernist composes a disunified text and wants you to see that. I want to show you two video clips to give you an example of the difference between modernism and postmodernism. So this is a scene from The Longest Day, which came out in 1962, which could have been about the time that we were starting to shift over to postmodernism, but not in film. Here, we're going to show you a clip of the scene of the American soldiers landing on the beach at Normandy during World War II. So here we have commander giving orders to his soldiers, and they can hear every word that the commander is saying. It's very linear. You have this noise, and yet somehow the soldiers are still able to hear their commander. They're still able to have a sense of what their goal is. Yes, we see something die. And they look very heroic with their pained looks on their faces. See the soldiers looking out for each other. Techniques are very much about pain and zooming, dollying, pain. Know that if he's not gone, don't be sad about it, but we're watching it from afar. Okay, now what I want to do is show you another clip that you might have seen before. This is the same scene. Notice the images at the beginning. Very purposeful on the part of Spielberg. This is from Saving Private Ryan. It's also Mojave. Notice the camera jogging up and down. So we feel like we're looking at those people on a ship as if we're on a ship. This is our heroic soldier. Doesn't seem very heroic. He has trembling hands. He needs to drink water. He's human. Of tobacco. We're puking on the ship because we can't handle the seasickness. Now we've got commanding officers giving orders, and as of right now, we can hear them. but I want you to pay attention to what happens when we get to the beach. So close on the soldiers that it just feels as though you're there in the moment with them. That's part of postmodernism. Watch a little more. Now, you start seeing again with promotion. Follow the end. We don't know what's going on. All of a sudden, our point of view shifts, and here, the enemy shooting. Tom Hanks' character is giving orders, and you can hear the skyline is going in and out of view. We're underwater. All of these elements throw us off balance and make things unclear. And we're watching soldiers die underwater, struggling, not in any heroic fashion, but as it probably actually happened, in fear. That's the difference between modernism and postmodernism. Now, I do have a word of warning about postmodernism. It's a tough lens to apply to some multicultural texts. African-American texts, GLBT texts, texts written by women. These writers are writing for self-affirmation. And what a deconstructionist says is the center does not exist. That's a tough space to be in when someone is trying to claim a center. However, Toni Morrison writes in a postmodern way, and it is for us to notice those many different things. So on your note-taking sheet, I want you to explain the concept of deconstruction in your own words. Use examples from Sula. How does deconstruction contribute to major themes in this novel? And what flaws does deconstruction have? What is it not good for? What does it hide from us if we just use deconstruction and no other literary lens? So what are you looking for as you're deconstructing a text? I want you to look for the assumptions. So what can you take apart? What assumptions may not be true? What bias is there by the characters in the text, in the setting in the text, in the conflict in the text? As we assume that Nell has every right to be angry at Sula for her actions, that's an assumption, isn't it? Sula didn't stand up and take an oath in front of God and man like Jude did. So that could be something that you could question. Look for tensions between the spirit and the letter of the text. So what is it that the author is going for? And what is difficult to grasp? Where is it incomplete or misleading? Or what does it assume that you know that you might not know? Consider the dynamic and static elements of meaning. Sorry, I love this little snail guy because he's saying to the other snail who has an acorn cap on his back, you should stop using whatever you find lying around. And the other guy is saying, no, be dynamic. Come on, move, shake, change. Don't just stay stuck in your little shell. So the meaning of text can change over time. What did the book mean when it was written versus what does it mean to us now? How have things changed? How can we modify the meanings for ourselves? And consider how the text is made irrelevant in some ways. This is what's a tough thing to do with a text by a writer of color, LGBTQ, disabled, female, any group that has not yet been able to establish itself. But I'm just teaching you about the lens here. Think about if this text were read as an alien object, and you're bringing that intense level of scrutiny to it, I want you to disturb the text in order to discover it. Don't just take the context for granted. So instead of finding the limits of meaning built into the text, I want you to find the point at which something becomes alien to us and really dig into that. You discover something new when you do that. Okay. Next, consider the individual elements of the text. That's often the first step in deconstruction, but it can be a little misleading because it suggests that meaning is the sum of separate parts and not something more than the sum of the parts. But think about how the text uses different kinds of words, nouns, verbs, adverbs. A text that describes the world using verbs constructs a very different kind of world than one that focuses on nouns. Verbs tend to be more existential, and nouns tend to be more essentialist or positivist, and adjectives are relativist. They're comparative and superlative. A text that uses verbs like appear or seem or ponder give us more of an imagined sense of reality than one that uses verbs like is or creates or proves. So think about even at the word level. That carries on to the next one. Look for puns and words with double meaning. You might have heard this, time flies like an arrow, but fruit flies like a banana. I think it was ascribed to Groucho Marx. In this image, what would it mean if you took time as not a noun, but an adjective? Time flies. It's a kind of fly, like a house fly or a bottle fly. Time flies. And like, instead of being a preposition, it's become a verb. They like an arrow, right? Like fruit flies like a banana. There are a lot of ways that you can take a sentence and play around with its meaning like that. So look in the text to think about any words that have puns or double meanings. And some of you already did that with the tie that Jude left behind. Next things in deconstruction look fors is hunt for overlooked explanations or definitions. So deconstruction wants you to resist the general or common meaning of a text and go deeper. So abandon the privileged meaning of the text, the schmoop, the cliffs, the spark notes, the pink monkey notes. Instead, think about alternative explanations that are ignored by a lot of people. Are there alternative perspectives that haven't been given their due? What's unconventional or strange about the text? Are there traditions that it's flouting? How would this text be different if it had been narrated from a different character's perspective? Think about the text's relationship to seemingly universal truths. Because deconstruction resists the idea that there's one single truth to explain life and language. Does the text resist those false truths? Right? People might say an accepted truth is people should follow their consciences. Maybe a text is arguing that people's consciences are flawed and that morality should be sought somewhere else. Like maybe Nell following her conscience, which isn't really her conscience, but it's the ideology of the bottom, which is really based on a lot of white values. Number 8, push back against the authority of the author. This is another one that you really shouldn't do when you've got women or people of color or all of those other marginalized groups. But Don't just look to the author of a text as the singular expert of the meaning of a given text. There are other readings and ideas and translations. Deconstruction look fors. Embrace ambiguity, playfulness, contradictions. Language can be strange and funny or disturbing or paradoxical. So look for ways that it has openness and you can mess around a little bit. Examine the text in another order. What's really interesting about Sula is that the chapter titles are years. However, Toni Morrison actually goes into a lot of things out of order, even though the book is chronological in some ways. So what is she doing by writing it that way? I want you to resist Western cultural binaries. I was talking about that with the black-white, but you could also think about it as male-female. I think I already said that. Culture versus nature, soul and mind versus body, reason versus emotion, adult versus child, good literature versus bad literature. And finally, the last step that you're going to do with deconstruction is, what do the disunities in the text that you found do? Make a claim about it. What is the author doing by building disunities into a text? Make a claim about it. What greater point does it make or not make? Even though the text appears to argue X, my reading shows that the text also argues Y. Or the text allows a reader to understand that the binaristic relationship between A and B is problematic in these cool ways. The text creates a surprising connection between P and Q through the use of puns and hidden jokes. And this is meaningful because... And I think that's where I ended. So what I'm going to have you do is I'm going to have you go to the question on Google Classroom, or the document, sorry, the document on Google Classroom, and post one gap or paradox or ambiguity or tension that you found in Sula. And hopefully we can have a big long doc of a bunch of things that each of you saw. You can add more than one if you want, but don't step on somebody else's. In this way, you'll be applying deconstruction to Sula. Thank you for listening. I'm sorry if this was a little long, and I look forward to talking to you soon.